All right, all right. Come on in the room. Come on in the room. Let's get ready. Let's get ready to praise the Lord together. Amen.
Amen.
Anybody glad to be here?
Hallelujah.
Hey, come on, women, where are you? Were you here Friday? Wasn't that powerful? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Ah, we're celebrating the Lord our God. He's great and greatly to be praised. Come on, let's get ready to celebrate him together. Lift your voices. Put those hands together. Hey, we're excited about his love that remains. Hallelujah. 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 Come on. Come on, put them together. Ah, ah. Come on, lift your voice and say, oh.
Your love.
runs out on me.
Hey,
your love.
Fails. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, God. We thank you that you're faithful to us. You know all about us and you yet remain faithful. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. You are our rock. You're our firm foundation. You're steady. We bless you, Father.
Is my firm foundation, the rock on which I stand. When everything around me is shaken, I've never been more glad that I put my faith in Jesus, 'cause he never lets me down. He's faithful. So why would he fail now? He won't.
Hallelujah. Bless you, God. Hallelujah.
We declare that this morning.
Hallelujah. Come on, I've still got joy. Come on.
I've still got joy in chaos.
Hallelujah. Come on, I've got peace.
I've got peace that makes no sense.
Ha.
So I won't be going under.
Come on, I'm not held.
I'm not. Rain came.
say it again.
He won't.
Every circumstance.
He won't fail. He won't fail.
Come on, every circumstance, we declare that you won't fail, God. Never, 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 never. You never fail. Oh. Ooh, 'cause Jesus never fails. Before you take your seats, bless him again one more time. God, we thank you that you are our sure foundation. Yeah. You're the rock on which we stand this morning. Woo, in confidence, Hallelujah. We rest in you. In Jesus' name, come on, put your hands together and you take your seats. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. As you take your seat, just turn around and tell three people he never fails. Come on, tell them he never fails. He never fails. He never fails. He never fails. Never fails. Amen. Amen. Well, welcome to the trip. It's so good to see y'all in the house today. Anybody glad to be in church this morning? Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hello.
How you doing?
I'm doing all right.
Y'all was up there singing, baby. Y'all was doing your thing.
He never fails.
He never fails. He never fails. He never fails. Hallelujah. Hey, I'm Albert, and this is?
La Rosa.
Ooh, you put that thing on it.
I don't even know why I did that, but come on, hallelujah. Now.
I like that. Come on. Look at it. Come on now. Yes. And this is my, black and Latino wife.
We have bilingual children.
La Rosa. That's what I'm about. La Rosa. Yes. Yes. Some of you. Anyway, all right. What are we doing? Oh,
we are
welcome
doing
to fellowship.
Yes,
yeah,
we
welcome
are.
Here. We are a gospel-centered, multi-ethnic, intergenerational church, and we exist to make disciples.
Yes, yes. And if that is your first time hearing it, that it means it's your first time being with us this morning. So if it is your first time, we would love to recognize you, give you a clap, and just say welcome. If it's your first time, would you just wave at us so we can say
just
good
morning?
Just
raise your hand. Welcome, welcome, welcome.
Thank you for being here. Hallelujah.
So glad to have y'all.
Thank you for being here. Thank you for being here. Thank you. Oh, my gosh. My son just raised his hand.
This is the first time. It's a fresh, it's
being
a new,
being a
new
life. Service. How about that?
What we got going on? Oh, the ladies I hear turned the place up last Friday night.
This past Friday
night,
yes.
Oh, my goodness.
It was amazing.
So y'all had a good time, huh,
babe? God did his thing. He did what only he can do.
Give me one highlight.
Well, first of all, can I just give it up for every single person that volunteered, and you know, if you brought a meal, if you set up,
let's thank all the volunteers.
Decorations, you moved a chair or chairs for the staff that was here beforehand and way afterhand.
Yeah,
it wouldn't be what it is if there were not people showing up to do that. And then we had four amazing ladies that shared a part of their story. And
yes.
I think each one of us can find ourselves in each part of their stories. And so I just think God did a work, and he's continuing to do a work. I'm still hearing stories, so.
Good. Yeah. Well, brothers, don't feel left out. We're getting together Saturday, October 5th, that morning. And we're going to have a good time, too. The Lord's going to do good stuff with us, too.
He always does.
And he's going to move with us, too. And we're going to have a panel.
He will do what only he can do.
We're
going to
have some men on the panel, and we're going to have a good time.
I think you're going to have a great time.
So,
and the ladies will be praying for y'all.
Thank you. Yeah. I appreciate that.
Because if it's as good as it was for us, y'all going to be blessed.
We're going to be blessed.
While
you pat me like I'm 3 years old.
Well, maybe I should.
No, you do this. Like, and we're going to be praying for y'all. And if it's good, that's what you did.
Maybe I should do this. We're going to be praying.
Ooh, don't do that, La Rosa. Don't do that.
It's La Rosa, not La Rosa.
Don't do that, La Rosa.
I'm going to need you to practice a little bit.
All right, we got stuff to do, babe. I got a sermon to preach. Let's move on. We are celebrating Vision Sunday, and this is the time of year where you just get in. We want to invite you to get in. We got Rooted groups. We got Life groups. Rooted group meets on Tuesday night here, and it's a 10-week discipleship journey that we go on together. Starts this Tuesday night, and I'm telling you, it's just amazing. It's a rich opportunity, and we're like a QR code church. That's a bad angle, camera guy. We're not going to do that. All right. is online to the whole world. We don't need the back of my head. Yeah, thank you, La Rosa. We got these QR codes up here, so grab your phones, capture that, and it'll take you to the link so you can get information about how to sign up for Rooted groups. And then we got Life groups, opportunity to do life with one another. It's an amazing way to live out the gospel and to be a part of Fellowship Church. So we invite you to get involved. We got information out at the Connect Center. We got the information on the QR code. We'd love to see you get connected this fall. Amen?
Yes, amen.
Yo, Fellowship is going to the Dodger game.
Woo!
We're going to see the Dodgers September 21st. Yes,
got,
she has
we
been.
We got one Dodger fan in the house.
Look at you. Sit down, lady. Sit down. She's been pushing to go to this Dodger game for weeks and weeks and weeks. So we are going, and I thought of you. We all gonna be sitting together, but the tickets are limited. We only got like 50 something tickets, and I think I'm telling you, them folks at 8:30, they picked them up, and these heathens that coming at 11:45, our last service, they probably going. You ain't no telling.
Out.
So grab those tickets now. And we're going to have a good time. The game is Saturday night. It's a giveaway game. So if you get there early, you get a T-shirt. So it's going to be a good time. What'd you say? Is the time wrong? Oh, is that 7? No. Okay. I thought I heard somebody say something. This is 6, right?
Yeah,
6:10. 6:10? Okay. So we're going to have a good time, y'all. Sign up for the Dodger game. Let's go. Huh?
Yeah, let's go.
All right.
Next Sunday.
No. We're not going to do that.
Okay, never mind.
Yeah,
sorry.
We'll change it.
Scratch that.
We have what we call fellowship time.
Yes, we do.
Where we all stand up,
yes,
get together.
We do.
This week they announce. So sports is starting. This
have
week they
started. Yes. Mm-hmm.
This week they announced the Super Bowl halftime show. It'll be Kendrick Lamar.
Yep.
And there's been a lot of opinions about whether that should have happened or not. Lil Weezy, I hear, was in his feelings because it's in New Orleans and he thought he should do it. So I thought of this for the question of the day: what is the best halftime show you've seen? or this halftime show you would love to see?
Who would you love to see?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. Kirk Franklin. I'm sorry.
Kirk Franklin?
I think he would do a really good. I think Kirk Franklin. To everybody, because everybody's not a Christian, but I think he would do a really great.
I think Kirk Franklin would be good.
Show.
Yeah, Kirk Franklin.
Probably never happen, but.
Yeah, it could. Kirk Franklin, and who else?
Because I mean, he could bring in a lot of artists. He's done a lot.
What artists would you want him to bring in? Like Kirk Franklin and like Beyonce.
Yeah.
That don't go together?
No.
Oh, okay.
That would not be a good
All right,
one.
We'll figure out what goes together. Yeah. Y'all stand up, turn around, greet your neighbor, find out what would be a good halftime show. Tell me when you're ready. Hey, Fellowship Online, thank you so much for joining us for our worship service. You are in for a treat. We are talking about vision and getting in and how to participate, and we want you to participate. We do have online Rooted groups and online life groups. So if you're in a different part of the country or world, we still love to get connected with you. But thank you so much for tuning in and being a part of our worship service. We value you so much. In the comments, who you want to do the halftime show? Who would you love to see? I think Kirk Franklin and me, we need a sermon. That's what I want to preach halftime. That's what we need to do. All right, welcome to church. Grab a seat. Grab a seat. Grab a seat. Excuse me. One second, right here. Grab a seat. Hey, good morning. Good morning. A big part of our worship is we get to give unto the Lord. From the resources that he's blessed us with. So a part of our worship, it's not just songs and sermons, but we get to offer to him out of the abundance of which he's blessed us. So as we prepare for our offering, I just want to pray for God's blessing. Thank you so much for being a generous church. Thank you for your faithfulness in giving. And there are multiple ways to give. You can text to give. You can give online. LaRosa and I just have it set up as a reoccurring online. Or you could give as we pass the buckets in the room today. If you're watching online, you can also give there as well. So we thank you so much for your faithfulness, and thank you for continuing to invest in the vision and the mission so that we might make impact for God's glory. Let's pray. God, thank you so much. Would you receive these gifts? May they go to the continued building of your kingdom. Father, would you continue to get glory as we give with grateful hearts, thankful for your generosity towards us. Receive these gifts now in Jesus' name. Amen. At the old church that I grew up in, we used to have what we call every now and then a message in song. You got the message, but then you got the message in song. So I want to invite Larissa and the worship team to give us today a message in song.
For what I want. and Jesus, you're my number one. So I will make room for you. I will prepare for two. So
Father, we pray that you move by your Spirit. Our desire is that you would be number one in our life. Recognizing that we make room for what we treasure, Father, may we make room for you. And if there's anything in the way, yes, Father, you can move that over. Father, we pray now that you'd speak, O Lord, like only you can. Your children have gathered to listen. Would you tune our ears to your voice so that we might hear you ever so clearly? Would you turn our hearts toward you so that we might experience the fullness of all that you have for us? God, it's to that end that I ask that you stand in my body, think with my mind, speak through my vocal cords, those things you would have us say, know, and do. May the words of my mouth, the meditation of my heart, be acceptable in thy sight. O Lord, you are my strength. You are my redeemer. Get glory in this place. In Jesus' name. Have your heart said amen? Amen. The year was 1829. His name was George Wilson. George Wilson would do something that would change the trajectory of his life. In a moment of anger and rage, he killed a mail carrier. He would be convicted of murder, and the judge would sentence him to death by hanging. Remember, it's 1829. George had some amazing friends that did not want to see this for his life, so they lobbied the President of the United States. And these friends had influence, and it was effective. The president ends up issuing a pardon for George Wilson. But to everyone's surprise and dismay, George Wilson says, no, thank you. He rejects the pardon. This would then provoke a series of court cases wrestling with, can George do that? So it goes all the way up to the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court issues this ruling. The court says the court cannot give the prisoner the benefit of the pardon unless he claims the benefit of it and relies on it by plea or motion. The form in which he may ask it is not material to this inquiry, but the claim must be made in some shape by him. It is a grant to him. It is his property, and he may accept it or not as he pleases. On the back of our shirts, we got this phrase, going after greatness. It comes out of the passage that we sat in last week in Luke 22, which I'll spend a little time there this week. In Luke 22, there's this tension because the disciples are fighting over who would be the greatest, who would sit in the seat next to Jesus. And then Jesus comes with this mind-blowing new perspective. He says, the Gentiles lord their power over one another. Gentiles come in the room and basically they seek to be served. The Gentiles seek to be served. In other words, in every room they walk in, they saying, what can I get out of this room? He says, we are not to be like them. He says, who do you think the greatest among? He said, who is the greatest? Is it he that sits or is it he that serves? And then he says, here's the line, I came as one who serves. So immediately he takes their understanding of greatness and he says, greatness is service. So the vision is go after greatness, go after service. And that's our call. And I'm telling you, each and every one of you in this room, there's a calling on your life. I know some of you are like, I'm just eight. Yes, you got an eight-year-old calling on your life. Some of you are 18 months and says, yes, there's purpose. There's more than just burping and poop in that 18-month-old. There's purpose in there. Some of you are 68. Some of you may be 86. There's purpose in there. Albert, how can you be so confident? Because you got breath in your body. And if you got breath in your body, that means you still got purpose in your chest. God's not done with you. Just encourage somebody and tell them that God's not done with you. Come on, tell somebody else. That was a terrible witness. There's no encouragement in that. Tell somebody else, God's not done with you. He's working his plan, but here's the deal. I can say that all day. And you can know that there's purpose, there's plan, each and every one of you. I'm trying to get all your eyeballs at one point before the end of the service. Each and every one, God has purpose. Means nothing if you don't receive it. It's like George Wilson in The Pardon. Had a pardon whole life. Pardon means nothing if you don't receive it. I guess what I want to say is you can have a whole life with this idea of intent, but not make any impact. Can I say that again? Some of you, you got great intentions. Oh my God. Some of you got vision boards. Oh! Some of you got a whole line. I want to do this. I want to do this. And I want to be that. But some of you got great intentions. But I'm telling you, you can have great intentions and make no impact if you don't receive the calling and the purpose of God on your life. Watch this. And you got to tap into your purpose. Got to tap into your purpose. Let me help you. Your job is not your purpose. You're a teacher. That's great. Ain't purpose. You're an engineer, beautiful, fix something, but it ain't purpose. You're a painter, sweet, paint all day, not purpose all day. It's not your purpose. Because what happens if you break your hand and you can't paint no more? Have you now, you lost purpose? What a terrible way to live. If I can't do something, then I don't have purpose anymore. God's thinking bigger than that. Your purpose is to love God and to be loved by God. And allow that love to overflow so that you might love one another. Your purpose is to be salt and light in the world. Why? Because folks are thirsty in this world. Yes. Folks desperately need to be made thirsty. And when you show up, you say, I'm salty. I'm going to create thirst in my relationships. Thirst for what? Thirst for God's righteousness. Thirst for God's love. So when you go to be a teacher, that's your assignment and your purpose as the teacher is to show the love and the light and the saltiness of God. As you're painting, it's to show the love of God. It is to be that thing in the earth that brings about hope and love and joy. But you will never walk that out if you don't receive that that's your assignment. You don't receive that. That's your calling and that's your purpose. And God is saying, that's your purpose. I need you to receive it and partner with me so that, watch this, my kingdom will come on earth as it is in heaven. Watch this, through you. Through you. How he gonna do that? You the how. Come on, you the how. Somebody say, you the how. Turn, tell your neighbor, say, you the how. Tell somebody else, you the how. You the how. That sounds like a good t-shirt. I like that. I'm going to put that on the, you the how. That's how God's going to bring purpose. That's how he's going to bring hope. That's how he's going to bring healing and deliverance. You the how. You're the how. He's going to use you. But you got to know that and you got to receive that. You got to own that that's what you have. You got to own that that's the calling on your life because you can have this great access, this great calling, this great purpose, and you can know it. But if you don't use it, it's to no avail. It's kind of like this. I went to a Dodger game last week. Me and LaRosa, we went to a Dodger game last week, and somebody gave us season tickets. So we had season tickets. I'm telling you, the tickets was right there off to the side, right behind the home plate. So we had good tickets. Not only that, we had good parking, too. That makes me almost speak in tongues. The parking is better than, you know, than the season tickets. You know what I'm saying? When you got season parking, child, we was in lot I space. Well, let me not give all my business. But we was right there. All I had to do was get out the car, and we walked right there to the place. Not only that, but we had access to the stadium lounge or something like that, where you just walk in, and there's just food everywhere. Like, and you ain't getting a Dodger dog. It's Dodger dogs. Like, they just laid out. Oh, my goodness. Like, this is how you do a game. As a matter of fact, this is the direct opposite of what we're going to do as a church on September 21st. These are the opposite seats of what we're going to be sitting in a couple of weeks, next weekend. But what if I had all that VIP access, but instead of parking in lot I parked way back in the hood? What if instead of sitting in my seats right there down front, I set up in the third balcony? What if What if instead of going to the stadium club, the stadium lounge, where they had all this food, I was sitting there in them seats hungry? You're like, bro, what are you doing? You got access to this parking, you got this food, and you got these seats? I can have all of that. But if I don't opt into it, if I don't lean into it, if I don't receive it, if I don't walk it out, it's as if I'd never had it. Oh, to live your life and to get to heaven and say, I don't know why you parked in insecurity all those years, because you had a VIP access to confidence and calling, but you never sat in the seat. God says, I've got you parked right here in purpose. Why you keep parking in confusion? Why you keep parking in anxiety? Why you keep parking in confusion when I've parked you right here in clarity and purpose and assignment? I guess what I'm trying to ask is, where are you parked today? Where are you parked? And are you missing the access that Jesus Christ has called you to? And the reason why he's calling you is because there's work to be done. We've got work to do. And you're missing the assignment because you're not walking in purpose. Let me tell you something. You are. Not you may be, you could be. I am speaking over life. You are an answer to somebody's prayers. You are. Because God made you on purpose. And his purpose is tied to the blessing of other people and one another. You, when you show up, God says, I want to use you today to answer somebody else's prayers. Amen. There's somebody over here praying something and you to answer to it. Amen, somebody? Like just yesterday, we had the financial management stewardship class, and literally the lady that was teaching the class, one lady said, I don't know what to do next. I think I want to start a business, but I don't know how. This lady said, I'm the answer to your prayer. I'm the answer to your next step. I know everything you just said you want to do, I know how to do. Let's meet on Tuesday for coffee. Just like that, you could be the answer. Like when I tell you, God ain't playing around, and he's very intentional. But we got to say yes. And we got to show up, and we got to be, here's the word, available. Got to be available. Can I tell you? God needs, this world needs salt and light. If you want to see how messed up the world is and where you can begin to see it shaping, go to a kindergarten classroom or an elementary classroom. That's why, this is one of the reasons why I think teachers should be some of the highest paid in our society. Like, teachers should easily make six figures for what we put them into. You, it is like, oh my God, teachers are amazing and we need to invest in them. I was talking to one teacher, and I've heard this story. She, in a lot of these classrooms, they're allowing the children to self-select their gender. So they get to walk in the room and decide what gender they want to be this semester. And then the teacher then is obligated to accommodate that. To accommodate that, they have to accommodate that. So they have to, you know, choose whatever pronouns they are. So that's one thing. Okay. Talking to a teacher, that's gone to a whole other thing where they have group that identifies as furries, where instead of choosing as a gender, I choose as an animal. So she was navigating a cat in her classroom, and he chose to identify as a cat, and the teacher is obligated to facilitate all the then trappings of having a cat in the class. So when he wants to get on the floor and stretch around, she's got to accommodate that. If he chooses to speak in cat, you know, meow throughout the class, she's got to interpret that. That ain't even where I'm going. I'm just setting you up. This is where I'm going. I heard of a teacher just in my office a couple of months ago, and she was leaving the district and just stepping away from school because a student that was identified at one thing last year has chosen to come back this year, and he's going to identify as mac and cheese. So he's going to be mac and cheese. And here's the thing. If it wasn't, it would be funny if it wasn't true. But this thing is so real and so true. You know what I mean? Like, I grew up in the South. Like, if you're going to identify as anything, I would identify as mac and cheese. Like, I mean, way to go. Like, that's the best thing. I mean, I didn't know that was an option when I was a kid. You know what I mean? I knew I could consume mac and cheese, but to be mac and cheese, I never know there was an option, right? So, so here's the thing, though. It's like, and I want you to hear this, church. I want to be a church where mac and cheese could come to. See, that's the flip. Did you see what you just, some of y'all, some of us, our reaction to that is always rage and frustration, and I get that. But we also need to be a place of love and kindness. Can you imagine what it must be like to be in the mind of someone who you can't figure out who you're trying to be and you're trying to figure out yourself? Right. Who tells a kid, you know, the reason why it's so overwhelming is because you don't get to pick. You've got a God that says, I've relieved you from that burden. I get to now tell you who you are. Amen. So your identity is anchored in Jesus Christ. And that way you don't go through decades trying to figure out who you are and becoming different things that you're trying to identify with. Someone needs to say the good news and say, hey, you got a God who tells you who you are. So until you can figure that out, you need to, you'll never figure it out on your own. You got to start trusting God and let him give you your identity. And I begin to think, because the church then, we can get up in these culture wars and think we should then start fighting one another, start fighting people and fighting in government and take over the school board and get over there and take out books. Like, I get out making sure that the Christian voice is in every sphere, but we just need to know that our voice will very rarely win in this sphere. Do you get that? Like, the elephant ain't gonna usher in the kingdom, and neither is the donkey. Neither one of them will ever get on a cross and sacrifice because the lamb already did that. I wish I had a witness up in hell. The lamb already did it. Jesus Christ is the Savior, and he's going to usher it in. But watch this. He's going to usher us into his kingdom, not this empire. See, so we got to be careful. I know we got a big election coming up on November 5th, but on November 6th, the kingdom of God will not be ushered in. I don't care who wins, they ain't going to be good enough. They're going to be a trip. It's going to be a hot mess. November, I'm going out of town. I don't even know where to go, but I'm going somewhere. Because whoever wins, it's going to be a hot mess up in here. Amen, somebody? And I know you feel good. No, I ain't going to bring back. Hey, I voted. I'm going to tell you, I'm an independent. I voted for Republican and Democrat and been disappointed both times. Disappointed consistently. Because it ain't the kingdom of God. And I know y'all, some of y'all, I see you on Facebook. It's like some of y'all think it is the kingdom of God. It ain't. The Republican red ain't ushering in the blood of Jesus. It's asking for it. And that Democratic blue ain't going to do everything for you. You know what I'm saying? I was thinking, who told me my identity? Like, who? Where did I get that from? Because I'm looking at our kids in the schools and stuff. And I'm like, they getting all kinds of stuff there. How do we get our, where do we get our sense from? And it hit me. It was Alma Jean. Here, put these pictures up. It hit me like a ton of bricks. You got them? Go ahead, put them up. This lady right here, that's Alma Jean Griffin. This lady right here is Lula Williams. This beautiful lady with the hat on, that's Juanita Knight. And this lady in the green, that's Audrey McAfee. Those were my Sunday school teachers. Anybody remember your Sunday school teachers? These were the folks that taught me theology. They've taught me where my identity come from. They've taught me Adam and Eve and Abraham and oh, and Sarah, and they was old, but then they got married, so be careful. You know what I mean? Like, then they got pregnant at an old age, so be careful. Like, I remember Alma Jean talking about that stuff. I remember walking through that, and I remember that's where I learned my identity. That's why I got my framework for how the world. So if I went in any other space and I was hearing something different, I'd be like, yeah, I see what you're saying, but Alma Jean already didn't tell me. Audrey McAfee didn't already told me, and they've anchored me in God's word. If you remember your Sunday school teacher's name, raise your hand. If you remember your Sunday school teacher from back in the day. See, that's so important. What was your Sunday school teacher's name? Cindy? Miss Cindy. What about y'all? Who had a Sunday school teacher? Y'all remember? This whole section don't remember your Sunday school teacher? Well, you section of heathens. What happened? No, over here. I saw a bunch of y'all in the back. Right, go ahead.
Deacon Jimmy Royce and Deacon Lindsay.
Yes, ma'am. Sister Vanderwalker. She sound like she did some things. Come on now. She taught you some stuff. Sister Vanderwalker. Yes. Miss Green. Our children today, who are their Sunday school teachers? Who's making sure that they get the anchoring that's necessary for them to navigate this world that we done created? One of the hardest areas to recruit is children's for our church. I'm talking about the fellowship right here. One of the hardest is the y'all and everybody's so glad to get, hey, take the kids and then get out of here and we're gone. We need to make sure we got some Alma Jean Griffiths over there. We need to make sure we got some Lula Williams over there. We need to make sure we got some Deacon Lindsay's over there. That's our opportunity to disciple the next generation. We don't fight culture with power and authority. No, we fight culture with love and influence. That's always how Jesus won. He didn't go, let's take down Rome. No. But that's how some of y'all look out here in these streets. They're like, oh, it's take down. It's like, you look like an idiot. Sit down. Like Jesus, Christians have never won with our vote. That doesn't mean, and I can hear y'all already, don't email me. Don't be so petty. Like, it's important to, yes, it's important to vote, and it's a God-given right, and we, especially my ancestors, they fought and died so that we could vote. So I'm going to vote. I'm not going to tell you who I'm going to vote for. But it ain't going to take rocket science to figure it out. And see, y'all, you don't even know what that means. What does that mean? I don't even know what that means. But what I'm saying is, whoever I vote for is going to be less than the kingdom. It's going to be less than God. So I'm not going to come out of the voting booth confident or excited. I'm going to come out saying, oh, help us, Jesus. Lord, help. It's like when you're trying to eat right and the only thing open is Taco Bell and Denny's. Like, you know what I'm saying? You're not going in either of those feeling good and healthy. You up in there, Lord, help me. Moon over my hammock, go ahead. You know, like you're not going to feel great about that decision, you know? I guess, but what I'm saying is if we really want to win, though, let's invest in our kids. If we really want to gain influence in society, let's pour into and disciple our kids. I want to challenge you, fellowship. I want a waiting list for our Sunday school teachers. Some of you, God is calling you to be a Sunday school teacher, so that 20 years from now, somebody will ask some of these kids, who was your teacher? And they're going to say you. And you need to make kingdom impact. I'm calling and challenging us. Serve. Pour into the kids. It'll transform a life. Don't just look at the news and get irritated and talk about, whoa, Lord, these people crazy. And don't fall into this trap. Someone else is going to do it. Some of you, even now, you're thinking the Holy Spirit convicting some of y'all. You're like, all these people, somebody else is going to do it. What if no one else is coming? What if no one else is coming? What if God is calling you? Now, I know some of you is like, Albert,
I'll greet. I can even be on the usher. You don't want me with kids. And you're right. We don't want you with kids either. So we're not talking to you. If you feel that way about yourself, we probably in agreement on that. I think you got a parking lot ministry, parking ministry in your hands. I guess I do feel like some of you are called to pour in our children, and we got to have that. But I also want you just thinking, Lord, I don't want to walk in this room every week and just consume. How can I contribute? What does contribution look like? And how can I contribute in a way that's impactful? Paul in 1 Corinthians 13, he calls out this dynamic that I think we all wrestle with. Listen to this. He says, if I speak in the tongues of men and or of angels but do not have love, I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. Listen to the extreme language of that. I come to that often. Basically, what he's saying is you can be really, really spiritual and have no love and have no impact at all. As a matter of fact, if anything you bring isn't based in love, it will have no impact. It's a waste of time. And then he explains what love is. He says, love is patient, love is kind. And the thing that I want us to fundamentally understand is that when we're called to serve because we're answering the call to love. But what you need to understand about love that most people miss, so if you don't hear nothing else I say, hear this. Love is not a feeling. Love is a choice. Can I say that again? Love is not a feeling. Love is a choice. And he's saying, if you do all of this spiritual stuff, but you don't choose love, if you don't choose to be kind, choose to be patient, choose to be loving, if you don't choose that, then you are wasting your time. He's saying love is patient. Why? Because patience is a choice that you got to choose. Why? Because it's not always easy to be patient. You got options with patience, especially with people that are hard to be patient with. So he's saying a part of loving is choosing patience. How do I choose patience? Listen, let me tell you something. We're a trip. God ain't never asked you about how you feel about anything. Have you noticed that in the Bible? He wasn't like, John, I want you to carry a cross, but wait, how do you feel about that? God ain't asked you about your feelings. Do you know how wild and undisciplined your feelings are? You know, your feelings are all over the place. I'm not saying you can't have feelings. I'm just saying the feelings can be in the car, they just can't drive. Do you understand what I'm saying? Some of y'all, you throw your feelings the keys and you just take me wherever you want to take me. Just go. Feelings, yo. So as we think about serving and showing up, it's not going to be based off of how you feel about it. Ain't nobody ask you how you feel about being obedient to God. Did you get that? You see what I'm saying? Like, because if it's in the question of being obedient to God, then it really doesn't matter how you feel. And feelings are so inconsistent. If you don't believe that, ask somebody that's been married for over 75 minutes. Oh, them feelings that can change. Yo, sometimes my wife feels like holding me. And sometimes my wife feels like holding me. Same hold, different feeling. You see what I'm saying? Oh, can I get a married witness up in here? Anybody married? You know what I'm saying? Like, yo, you know how inconsistent my feelings can be? It's, God says, love your enemies. He ain't say like them. Like is to prefer, right? Like there are things I prefer that are opposite of God's love. So that's why I gotta choose love. I prefer not to be patient today. But I'm going to choose to be patient because I'm choosing love. Do you understand what I'm saying? So it's not about me choosing, It's not about how I feel and what I feel. Let me tell you something. Your feelings will get you in trouble. Y'all hear me in here? Your feelings will, let me clarify, because I can feel some of you say, well, we're allowed to feel. Yeah, shut up. Yes, you're allowed to feel, but here's the deal. Like, Psalms is full of feelings, right? Some they feel, you feel. Matter of fact, one psalm is so gangster. He's so angry. He says, smite my enemies. And then homeboy says, and if anybody tries to help their children, kill them. I don't want their children to, I want their children to suffer. I was like, dang, bro. But then he gets to the end and says, but Lord, not my will. I trust you above all else. So please, I surrender to you. Right? That's what you do with your feelings, right? You get to express them, but they don't like I always feel like eating fried chicken. Always. There has never been a time in my life where I didn't feel like eating fried chicken. And it ain't even because I'm black. I tested it. I talked to other black people. They like, nah, we don't want it as much as that. Like, it's 6:30 in the morning. They like, I don't want no chicken at 5, 6:30 in the morning. I'll take some. I'll have some, please. Like now, you know how sometimes people be like, man, I done had enough chicken. I don't want no more fried chicken. I've never said that. I've never felt that. I've never even thought it. I can't imagine the thought. Like, if somebody brought a bucket of Popeye's chicken, a box of Popeye's, I'd eat it right now. And I love preaching, but I love chicken a little bit more. You know what I'm saying? Well, first of all, I think both are godly. I think God created them both. Here's the problem. My cardiologist says, hey, you keep eating this chicken, you're going to die. Here's the irony, though. I feel like eating it all the time. What I just learned about my feelings is my feelings can very well lead me to my death. Can I say that again? Your feelings can lead you to your death because your feelings are not your mind. Feelings don't think. They just feel. And they're real sensitive too. That's why some of y'all be like, oh, you hurt my feelings. You hurt my feelings. Your feelings shouldn't be so easily hurt. But they're so sensitive, and all they know to do is feel. That's why they can't have the keys. That's why you're not waking up in the morning making decisions based off of how you feel. If that was the case, I wouldn't be here today. Because I was up late last night. I'm starting my celebration, my birthday. My birthday is tomorrow, by the way. So my birthday is tomorrow. Yeah. Praise the Lord. We should put my Cash App up. Do we have a Cash App? No. Whatever. But I'm starting to turn up. I was up last night. I fell asleep on the couch. Woke up at 2 a.m. Hey, let me tell you something. I didn't get to the church this morning. You know, we have a service. I don't know if y'all heard of it. We got a service at 8:30. But I know y'all come at 10 because I wasn't the only one having a good time last night. I got here at 8:30 this morning. I did not want to come. I didn't feel like it. I didn't feel like this preach. I didn't feel like this sermon. So we don't get to wake up in the morning and make decisions based off of our feelings. Because if we did, do you know how many things I would never do? Amen, somebody? So as you think about your availability and God using you and serving and showing up in community, this is not a feelings decision. This is a calling decision. This is about obedience. This is about trust. This is about inviting God to lead you so that you can become who God has called you to be. Amen, somebody? Some of you, I just want to sit in this. I feel strong. Some of you, you've been making major decisions based off of your feelings, and you've been missing the harvest of God because you're ignoring your calling and listening to your feelings. You need to get out of your feelings and get into your faith. Can I say that again? Yeah. That was good. Do you see how that play on words? That's like a thing, you know? Like, come on. Get out of your feelings and get into your faith. Some of you, God is calling you on an assignment that doesn't feel good. Doesn't even feel right. You know why? Because you love comfort so much. So sacrifice will hardly ever feel right. It won't feel good for sure. God says, get out of your feelings, walk in your faith. God wants to use you. You are someone's answer to prayer. God is going to choose to use you in that way. Finally, we'll go home on this. In Acts 2:42, Jesus had resurrected from the grave and ascended to glory, and the birth of the church happened. And here you have the church coming together. And this is how it describes the church at that time. They were devoted. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. I want you to think about the other 6 days. Somebody say the other 6 days. I appreciate you coming on Sunday morning, and I appreciate this time of opening God's Word. I think it's so powerful what God does on Sunday, and those of you that serve to help Sunday happen and to make Sunday happen. But I want you to think about the other 6 days and how might God want to use you in community, in the breaking of bread, in fellowship with one another. That's what happens in rooted groups. That's what happens in life groups. The greatest part of our church doesn't happen in rows. It happens in circles. Where we get to do life with one another. I know some of you, you say, well, what if I have somebody awkward in my group? Well, if you show up, you probably will. What if I don't like everybody in my group? Do y'all not remember Jesus? I mean, Judas was a crook, and he was in Jesus's group. What you expect in yours? So don't allow people or those dynamics to cause you to miss the fruit of what happens when people get together and do life with one another. We encourage one another. One passage in Hebrews, and we'll go home on this. It says we literally spur one another along. It's the idea. It's very vivid. It's a very vivid picture. We push one another along. It's kind of like this. Joel, come here, help me. Jamie, come here, help me. Put that coffee down and help me. Come here, help me. Help. It's the idea of that community. It literally pushes one another along. Y'all push me, y'all push each other. It's like we're pushing one another. You're strong, bro. You work out. I didn't expect that one. It's the idea, but we're pushing each other to good works. Do you have a community that's designed in its nature to push you to good works? Push you to being a better husband. If I push him to be a better husband, let me push you. Stop pushing so hard on me. Right? Because it goes both ways, right? If someone's just only pushing you and you can't ever push them, that makes them a Pharisee, right? Did y'all see what I just did there? That was a lesson, see? So it's got to go both ways. I got to be able to push you. And you got to, oh, now you go all soft. You just feel, hey, he was like a feather. He's like, ooh. Like, no. He set me up. I know, you set me up. You gotta have community that pushes one another along. And if you don't have that, you're missing the fullness of what it means to be in the body. This ain't the best part of fellowship. I know the music is good and the preaching is all right. I mean, but this ain't the best part. The best part is when you get in there, come here, y'all, come here, come here. And when you get in community, and we can begin to push one another to be better, and we can begin to stir one another along. And watch this, she's gonna really like me. Because every time her husband hang out with me, he come home better. My wife gonna really like him. So it puts an end to you. I mean, how many of you wives hate your husband's friends? Well, you know what I'm saying? That's why y'all be like, no, you going out with him again? Well, my wife loves sending me out to my friends because I come home a better husband. I come home a better dad. Get friends. And this is where, ladies, you should be manipulative. Listen, manipulation is not a bad word within itself. You should manipulate. And if you see another good guy, say, hey, why don't you hang out with that guy? I want you all to be like, I invited them over. We all going to the movies together. Or let's go and get our seats at the Dodger game together. Because you're like, I want my husband to hang out with him. Oh, don't look like y'all don't ever do that. Y'all manipulate us all the time. Some of you got an Amazon box in the trunk right now. You hope we don't open it. But this is This is what community does. And this is what we're calling you to, where we spur one another along to good works. Amen? You guys have a seat. Thank you so much. I'm going to, speaking of manipulation, Maestro, play some emotional music right now. Thank you. Oh, that sounds good. That's smooth. That's good. That's good. There's no way we pull any of this off if we don't make room for it. Some of you just sitting here right now, you think about your calendar, think about all the stuff you got going on, and you think there's no way I got room to do anything else. And I just want you to understand that you're saying there's no way that I have room to be obedient to what God is calling me to do. And is that how you want to be led in your life? That's why I love this song. It says, whatever it is, Lord, that gets in the way of you moving in my life, if it's in the way, you can move it over. The question I want to ask as we prepare to close is there anything in your life that God needs to move over so that you might have time to be available and used by God? So that you can walk in every room, our church, and say, what does it mean for me not to be a consumer only, but a contributor? Not just the church room, but you can walk in the boardroom and say, how can I contribute? Walk in the bedroom, how can I contribute? Walk in the living room, how can I contribute? What does it mean for you to see your life as Jesus sees your life? And that's a life that's going after greatness, that's going after service. And then we can celebrate God's faithfulness and how he has used our life for his glory by eating a box of chicken for his glory. Amen. Would you bow your heads and close your eyes? Whatever it is, Lord, you can move it over. We want our family, our identity to be anchored in us answering your call of purpose and service. Father, we are available to you. And whatever's in the way, would you move that over?
So I will make room for you. I will.
This is our prayer, Lord.
Prepare for two, so you can live in me. I will make room for you.
This is our surrender, Lord.
Prepare for two, so you don't feel that you can't live. Can live. Please live in me.
This is our prayer. Whatever is in the way, Lord.
Your will,
you can move that over.
Your way, yeah,
you can move that over.
My ego,
you can move that over.
My plans,
you can move that over.
My schedule,
you can move that over.
My itinerary,
you can move that over.
See, I will make room.
Yeah.
My habits,
you can move that over.
My attitude,
you can move that over.
Whatever it is,
come on, help us sing it.
Move that over.
That's not like you.
Come,
you
can move that over.
Whatever it is,
hey,
you can move that over.
You can move it over.
You can move that over.
Oh, I will.
One last time. Come on. Lord, have your way in my life.
Move that over.
That's in your way.
You can move that over.
Whatever it is.
You can move that over.
If it takes your space.
You can move that over.
Whatever it is.
You can move that over.
Stand with me. You extend your hands. Palms up. This is that posture that says, Lord, I'm available. Notice I don't have you have your hands fists clenched, because whatever's in there can't get out, but you also can't get nothing new in. So, Lord, we release the clenched fist. And we just open our hands and say, Lord, would you just have your way in my life? I'm going to go to work tomorrow, and I don't know what it means to be a contributor, but I'm going to try to just say, Lord, how can I bring kindness to the office tomorrow? How can I bring patience to the office tomorrow? How can I bring humility? I'm going to school. I'm going to class, and I don't know. How can I bring humility and kindness to my math class tomorrow? Lord, just I want to be available. I want to be used. Those that want to be a Sunday school teacher, want to pour into the next generation. They just want to serve their church, help their church be the best that it could be. They want to serve their family, serve their neighborhood. Father, we receive the call to be salt and light and love in the earth. We understand that we are the how. So we say to you, we're available. Use us, and may we spur one another along. May we push one another to go after greatness for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you, fellowship. Have a great week.
You can move that over. You can move that over. My ego.
You can move that over.
My plan.
You can move that over.
My schedule.